and I wished that I had never been born.
Vera was no longer the young patriot of just a year before and was getting a taste of the hideous reality of war. Her lifeline remained Roland, to whom she continued to write almost daily. But to her dismay, something was happening to him in France. The long love letters he used to send her no longer flowed freely, and her letters were greeted with silence.
Sometimes, when after a particularly grey and monotonous day, I wish for a letter from you to cheer me up and don't get it, I feel almost angry, though more with life in general than with you. With you, I never can be quite angry.
To try to understand Roland's state of mind at this time, I've come to meet Roland's nephew, David Layton.
So many moustaches, aren't there?
Well, everybody had to have a moustache. I mean, they're only 19.
Yes, I know.
They had to appear frightfully mature. I mean, if you're giving orders to 35-year-olds who've been in the army for 10 years, you really have a bit of size. You need a bit of size.
Yeah. David, at one point during their writing relationship, shall we call it, Roland's letters became quite emotionally distant, really. Do you think that was because he was letting Vera down gently? Was he preparing her for the inevitable? Why do you think that was?
I think we need to look at Roland's position, really. A very young man, 19 to 20, responsible for the lives of 30 men, many of whom would have been older than he was, and with families of their own back home. They were all living in atrocious conditions, coping with mud and vermin, and being shot at. I wonder just how much mental energy anybody would have to cultivate a personal relationship back home in those conditions. And of course, more than that, they were surrounded by death all the time. I think everybody there must have felt they had something of a rendezvous with death. And he must have wanted to prepare Vera for the possibility of a life without him.
As Christmas approached, there was good news. Leave had been cancelled for most of the men at the front who faced having to make the best of it in their frozen trenches. Roland was one of the lucky few, however, who were granted leave to return home. Thrilled by the news, Vera put all her concerns about his recent silence to one side and made plans for Christmas. She even began to imagine that they might marry during his week's leave. Roland was going to make his way to the Grand Hotel in Brittain, where Vera and her family were eagerly awaiting him. Roland was due to arrive on Christmas morning, and when he didn't turn up, Vera just assumed there'd been some delay in the channel. On tenterhooks with excitement, she sat in the Grand Hotel waiting for news, either by telegram or by phone. And in Testament of Youth, she says, "I waited, sitting drowsily in the lounge of the Grand Hotel, or walking up and down the promenade, watching the grey sea tossing rough with white surf-crested waves, and wondering still what kind of crossing he had had or was having."
The next morning, I had just finished dressing when the expected message came to say that I was wanted on the telephone. I dashed joyously into the corridor. But the message was not from Roland, but from his sister Claire. It was not to say that he had arrived home that morning, but to tell me that he had died of wounds at a casualty clearing station on December the 23rd.
Vera was devastated. Roland had been the focus of her life and dreams, and suddenly he was gone. More distressing still, Vera discovered that he had not died as part of any daring attack. The circumstances of his death were sadly mundane. He had gone out to check the wire in front of his trench under full moonlight. A German sniper had seen him and shot him through the stomach.
Now, Vera had just turned 22 and Roland had been 20. His death was utterly devoid of all the heroic limelight they dreamed of at the beginning of the war. And I'd imagine at this point, For Vera, the true devastation of war must have been coming much closer.
Horror was added to her sense of loss. When Vera visited Roland's parents in January, his clothes had been returned from the front. She described unpacking them.
The smell of those clothes was the smell of graveyards and the dead. The mud of France which covered them was not ordinary mud. It had not the usual clean, pure smell of earth, but it was as though it were saturated with dead bodies. Dead that had been dead a long time. After the clothes had gone, we opened the window wide and felt better, but it was a long time before the smell and even the taste of them went away.
After being shot, Roland had been taken 10 miles from the battlefield to Louvencourt. It was here he died. I've come to France to look for his grave, much as Vera's brother Edward did when he made his own pilgrimage in April 1916, just after he was posted to France. And he wrote a letter to Vera about it on the 30th of April, 1916.
It was a fine but dull evening. About 6 o'clock, I was coming up the hill from the valley south of the village.
I came upon the small military cemetery quite suddenly before I was quite in the village. It is very small and the graves are in neat rows all close together.
I walked up the path and stood in front of the graves. And I took off my cap and I prayed to whatever God there may be that I might be worthy of the friendship of the man whose grave was before me.
But I did not stay there long because it was so very clear that he could not come back.
And though it may be that he was watching me looking at his grave, yet I did not feel that he was there.
Roland's death must have felt to Vera like the end of everything. But there was some light in the darkness. All too aware of her fragile emotional state, and with her brother away in France, two other young men came to Vera's aid. One was Victor Richardson, the third member of the Three Musketeers from Uppingham. With the death of his great friend Roland, he turned to Vera. Mark Bostridge, Vera's biographer, has traced the special relationship that began to evolve between Vera and Victor.
The first thing he's trying to do is to convince her that Roland's death hadn't been in vain, that actually Roland had been very brave to go out and fix the wire and that he had saved his men's lives by doing so, and that was the action of a good officer. But he's also trying to help her get through this terrible period. I mean, he's written a letter here where he talks on the 8th of February, he's in Kent, and he writes to Vera and he says, "I feel that in a way it helps me to repay a little of the great debt I owe to him," him being Roland.
"For he, as you say, would have been most grieved if he could have known what you must suffer on his account. And I somehow think he would have thought me the right person to whom you could talk about him."
Now, as you notice in this letter, all the H's are capitalised. As
very Roland has, reverential,
it
isn't
is. It? He's become a kind of god, hasn't he? And Roland had confided to Victor about his relationship with Vera. When Roland was falling in love with Vera, Roland had told Victor about it. So Victor is saying, you know, that I feel I'm continuing the work he would have wanted me to do by talking to you about him.
Vera and Victor met regularly at the Trocadero in London. For Vera, he was a real source of comfort. He encouraged her to write when she felt lonely or depressed.
Vera had one other shoulder to lean on, Geoffrey Thurlow. He was a more recent acquaintance whom Edward had befriended since joining the army. Vera met him in October 1915, where he was invited to Buxton by the Brittain family, and she'd been instantly struck by his sensitivity and idealism. On October the 11th, 1915, she wrote to Roland,
"I liked Thurlow so much. Whatever Edward's failings, I must say he has an admirable faculty for choosing his friends well.
Despite the brevity of their acquaintance, Geoffrey nevertheless felt that there was a sufficient bond between him and Vera to offer her support. From France, he wrote a short formal letter. Dear Miss Brittain, please pardon me for writing to you. I am very, very sorry. May you be helped through this terrible time. There are times, I know, when letters are but empty things and I cannot write. Geoffrey was very different from Roland and Victor. He lacked their self-confidence.
In this letter that Geoffrey writes to Vera, he's expecting an attack and he says, "All I hope is that I don't fail, for I must confess I'm a bit of a coward, to use a strong word. Not so much for myself, but for the men under me, I'm afraid. Still, let's hope for the best." And there's this kind of jaunty sort of
gung-ho,
but underneath it all, there is real fear. And because Vera herself is of a nervous disposition, she's quite a nervy young woman in some ways and becomes more so as she gets older, I think she responds to this nervousness in Geoffrey very much.
In February of 1916, Geoffrey was wounded at Ypres and sent back to hospital in London. Vera rushed to visit him.
There's an account in the diary of Vera having been to see Geoffrey, which you might like to read.
Okay. Just here, yeah. We got quite intimate once more. I like him and I think he likes me.
He calls himself a weird bird, in which case I would fit in with him, as I am certainly another. When he came to the door with me, he asked me if he might come up to town when he was a little more fit and take me to a concert.
The offer pleased me. Yeah, she's...
She's getting more interested.
She is getting keen on him, isn't she?
But it's sort of sweet, the way she turns to her brother's friends. You know, it's not women friends that are sustaining her during this period. It's her brother's male friends.
She's a man's woman.
She's a man's woman, like you, Jay.
As Geoffrey recovered, he took Vera to concerts at the Queen's Hall. Perhaps the pain she had suffered with her fiancé Roland's death subsided for a brief moment. But through all this, Vera remained terribly worried about her beloved brother Edward. He was now in the Somme region and about to be engaged in some of the fiercest fighting of the war. On July the 1st, 1916, the first day of the Battle of the Somme, the British suffered 57,000 casualties and more than 19,000 dead. It was the bloodiest day in the history of the British Army. These appalling casualties gained them only 2 miles of ground.
As it turned out, Vera's anxiety was justified.